A Society for Neuroscience Archival Interview with Professor Edward Kravitz.
All right, and they do it with their forelegs and their other legs, and they're just pushing against each other, trying to push the other guy off the surface. That's low intensity. And at the mid-intensity, there's some chasing behavior, where one goes chasing after the other. And clearly, this is a winner in this fight. And then here's some, my favorite, boxing, where they actually get up on their hind legs and they duke it out. And this is a rare pattern of behavior, but you can see it here, and we do see it in many of the fights that we carry out. Then something even rarer is tussling. Steve Kuffler had just moved up to Harvard with a group of colleagues from Johns Hopkins. And Steve was the one who had the vision that in studying the nervous system, you had to put together people doing physiology with people doing anatomy with people doing biochemistry. So Steve was looking for a biochemist. He contacted Roy Vagelos, in whose lab I was working, actually working in Earl Statman's lab, but Roy was his second in command, and asked Roy whether he wanted to come to Harvard. And Roy said, no, no, he wasn't interested. But there was this guy who was always talking about the nervous system. Steve said, had an interview with me at NIH and said, come on up and visit us. So I did. This was 1960 when I first met Steve. Steve Kuffler and Dave Potter had already started working on the GABA project with a chemist by the name of Kaji. Steve, Dave, and Kaji had shown that there was GABA in the crustacean nervous system by grinding up a lot of brains. So Steve was following up on the physiological work that he had done and other eminent physiologists had done on the possibility that GABA was a transmitter. But if it was a transmitter, it had to be there. Florey, who originally made the suggestion that GABA was a transmitter on the basis of an inhibition of a crustacean stretch receptor. This was a muscle that when you stretched activated a sensory nerve, and the activation of that sensory nerve was inhibited when you stimulated either an inhibitory nerve to the preparation or when you put GABA on the preparation. And on the basis of that alone, Florey suggested it might be a transmitter in a short communication. By the time of the Congress in 1959, and then a second international Congress, I don't remember where that one was held, Florey's opinion had changed about whether GABA was a transmitter compound. And the opinion of other people who were interested in GABA, particularly in the vertebrate CNS, like Jack Eccles, had also changed. And those people felt that GABA was not the transmitter compound. So when I arrived, I knew Steve Kuffler and Dave Potter had told me about the GABA project. So I knew they were very interested in GABA, and then I saw the methods that they were using to show that GABA was found in the crustacean nervous system. And they were kind of old-fashioned by biochemist standards. They were elaborate, they were accurate, but they were old-fashioned. I knew they were going to need a better and a more sensitive assay for GABA. So I arrived from NIH with a test tube in my pocket. And the test tube was a strain of bacteria that Jacoby and Scott had generated at NIH. And they did this by taking bacteria and growing it on GABA as a sole carbon source. And by doing that, the bacteria made huge levels of two enzymes that could be used as an assay to quantitatively measure GABA. So I figured that with an assay like that, I should be able to detect very, very small quantities of GABA, detect it very accurately, and bring a new assay. And it was based on methods that Oliver Lowery had worked out at St. Louis, involving reduced pyridine nucleotides. But what happens is GABA is metabolized and you generate reduced pyridine nucleotide, and the reduced pyridine nucleotide can be measured at very low levels. So that was a huge advance, and it let us look at single axons. It let us look at single cell bodies. So although the concentrations in the single axons were staggeringly high, 10th molar, 0.1 molar, and that's enormously high for any of the transmitter compounds along the length of the axon, the total amount of GABA that was in a single axon was very small. It was in that range of 10 to the minus 9 to 10 to the minus 12 molar, but at enormous concentration. And again, Florey didn't expect that anything could be in such high concentration in a single axon, which again is part of the reason that he said GABA was not the transmitter. The other part was he didn't detect any, and that was because his methods weren't sensitive enough. At that point, we had shown that that GABA was in the right place. It was concentrated in the inhibitory neuron, and there was none detectable in the excitatory neuron. The precursor of GABA, glutamate, was found symmetrically distributed between the two. But GABA was only found in the inhibitory. So we actually started moving in two directions at the same time. One was to work out the metabolism of GABA in the lobster to see if we could explain why GABA would accumulate to such a high level in the inhibitory neuron. But the other, and this was the crucial experiment that the physiologists were waiting for, was to demonstrate that when you stimulate the inhibitory nerve, GABA is released, and that the release of GABA is dependent on the presence of calcium in the bathing medium. That experiment was why the physiologists hadn't been done. It's why the physiologists were not claiming that GABA was a transmitter, even though they all suspected that it was. So for that purpose, we tried a variety of preparations. And this is a lobster. And the one that proved the most valuable to us, the lobster has two claws. One is called the cutter claw. It's got sharp teeth on it. The other is called the crusher claw. And if you put a pencil in that, it actually can crush a pencil. The prep that we finally used to demonstrate the release of GABA was the opener muscle of the dactyl, the movable finger on the crusher claw, where the size of the muscle was large enough that the very tiny quantities of GABA that were being liberated could be detected by our biochemical methods. This is a schematic showing how we do the experiments. So you take the single nerves that innervate the muscle fiber, and you suck the excitatory nerve into one electrode and the inhibitory nerve into another so you can stimulate during the course of an experiment. You take fluid that you superfuse across the muscle fiber, you drip it in with a small capillary pipette, and the fluid washes across the muscle, and anything that is released when you stimulate the nerves is washed into this beaker down below, and that's what we purify the GABA from. We also have a recording electrode in the muscle fiber, so we can make sure that the nerves are working when we do the excitatory inhibitory nerve stimulation. The amounts of GABA that we were looking for were 10 to the minus 13, 10 to the minus 12 moles of GABA in the presence usually of 50 milliliters of half molar sodium chloride. So we had to first purify the GABA out of those samples and then quantitatively measure the GABA with the enzyme assay that we had developed. The experiments were difficult. They were long-lasting, and for the most part, they worked pretty well. And they were able to allow us to demonstrate the release of GABA only when we stimulate the inhibitory nerve, that the release was proportional to the frequency of stimulating the nerve, and that the release absolutely depended on the presence of calcium in the bathing medium. We were just lucky that it worked. I mean, you know, because there were so many steps involved. And we had a group of four absolutely wonderful scientists working on it together. Les Iverson, Masanori Otsuka, Zach Hall, and myself. And actually, the very last experiment was completed by me, begun by all of us, but completed by me while Les Iverson was on his way to England, Masanori Otsuka was on his way to Japan, Zach Hall was on his way to the West Coast for his postdoc. They all left without knowing whether this last experiment had left. And of course, we had no email, so it had to be done by phone calls and snail mail. But when they heard that the experiment worked, everyone just was absolutely delighted. The first talk I gave was on this was in Woods Hole to a rather large audience. And the first question, and I was proud, you know, to give such a talk. There are only two transmitter compounds that had been identified. The last one, 20 years earlier, both of those got a Nobel Prize for the work. So I was, you know, feeling pretty good about getting up and giving this work. And the first person who stood up was David Nachmanson, a very prominent biochemist from Columbia University. And Nachmanson said, well, we don't know what this tiny little bit of GABA is that you get when you stimulate the inhibitory nerve and what it's related to, because we all know that chemical transmission doesn't exist and that transmission is all electrical. So I was flattened. I didn't know what to say or how to respond. Here's a very senior person in the audience, and I was this very young person presenting the talk. And I can't say, no, you're wrong. But luckily, Steve Kuffler sprung to my defense and explained what we had done and why we had done it and why we thought differently, why we thought there was chemical communication. Les Iverson gave a comparable talk in England at the Physiological Society, and the same thing happened to him there. And there, Bernard Katz sprung to his defense. So we were lucky in a way that we had some strong defenders there who would stand up for us when senior people in the field were questioning what we thought was a very clear case that established GABA as a transmitter compound. Along with the release experiments, the other side of the story was the metabolism of GABA. Why and how did it accumulate to this staggeringly high concentration only in inhibitory nerves? And then how did the nerve muscle preparation we were working with get rid of GABA? I mean, once it's released, there had to be an inactivation mechanism. And for acetylcholine, it was known that an enzyme was the inactivation mechanism, the enzyme that cleaved acetylcholine into its component parts. For norepinephrine, which was the other transmitter that was known at the time, there was an uptake mechanism. Les Iverson, before he came to our lab, had been working on the uptake of catecholamines, particularly of norepinephrine, and doing the pharmacology of norepinephrine release. So Les said, well, there's no obvious enzyme that's going to destroy GABA other than the transaminase and dehydrogenase, and those are intracellular. So we need some way of getting rid of the GABA. And that led us to start experiments on the uptake system. Was there a GABA uptake system that removed the GABA once it was released by the nerve? So Les started those experiments looking at both GABA uptake and glutamate uptake, the precursor of GABA. And by then, of course, glutamate was very much in the air as the possible excitatory transmitter compound as well. And with Les, we published a paper showing that there was an uptake system for GABA and an uptake system for glutamate, and these were both very efficient at removing the amino acids from the tissue. We thought, well, perhaps we could develop a single method that would let us measure all of the transmitter compounds that were known at the time in a tissue. And to do that, we had to have some way of separating all these transmitter compounds and quantitating them. So we developed a method whereby we put the precursor compounds in a radioactive form of all of the transmitter compounds, choline for acetylcholine, glutamate for glutamate and GABA, tyrosine for norepinephrine, and octopamine, which was the equivalent of that in the crustaceans, and dopamine, tryptophan for serotonin. And we put the radioactive precursors of those together with a tissue, and then needed a method where we could separate the precursors and the products from each other in a single step, if possible. And a machine became available at that time called high voltage electrophoresis, and an apparatus. And what this involved is a very, very long sheet of paper on which you could put a sample, tissue sample, and then you could put a charge across the paper, and the charge would separate all these compounds from each other on the basis of their charges, and the size. Size and charge would distinguish it. The problem was you needed very high voltages and very high currents to do this. And in fact, the sheet of paper was several feet long. It was dipped in a buffer solution on either side so that you would have electrical continuity, and the paper was wet. You would have electrical continuity between the paper and the two buffers. And then we would put up to 10,000 volts at something like 500 milliamps across that paper, which would easily electrocute a person. This was all put in a safety hood and a chamber. We had a giant power supply, and we had a cover that we put down on the top of the apparatus, and we turned it on, and it got very warm when it was running because of the amount of current flowing. But in a single step, it separated out all the radioactive products, and then we could just scan the radioactivity and quantitate. So it was a way of demonstrating what transmitters were there and how much of the transmitters would be made in a particular piece of time in a tissue. It got the nickname the hot zap. And the reason for that is the staggering voltages and currents that we were using. People were nervous around the apparatus and never forgot their first experiences of setting this up and slowly cranking up the voltage to these staggeringly high levels and watching the milliamp dial go higher and higher. So today there are other methods for separating almost all of these things. There are enzyme assays for some of these substances. Mass spec is now much more commonly used, and so mass spec methods would be an easy way. Take a sample, put it in the mass spec, and see what's there. So there are methods that are just as sensitive, and with some separation by column chromatography or gas chromatography, you can separate compounds easily from each other, and you can quantitate them using any of a variety of methods. Sidney Brenner sent Tony Stratton to us as a postdoc. There were no methods available to look at an identified cell and all of its branches in the nervous system. And since we were interested in the structure of crustacean ganglia, lobster ganglia, and knew that cell bodies were pretty much in the cell place, same place from animal to animal, and we could start mapping the positions of cell bodies, we needed a method where we could put something into an identified cell, get it to spread through the cell and all of its branches, and allow us to visualize a single neuron in all its branches in the nervous system so that we could then compare the same nerve cell in different animals and ask whether this is associated. The only method that was available at the time was the Golgi method. This is in the late 1960s, and the Golgi method was wonderful for looking at a cell and all of its branches. It had been used for 70, 80 years after it was originally developed and worked on by Golgi and Cajal. But it was with cells that were not identified other than the general type of cell. You could not find the same cell in two animals and say this cell has this kind of shape in one animal and this kind of shape in the other. It could only be done if you could put a dye of some sort into the cell you were interested in and then find the same cell in a different animal and look at the arbors of endings of both of those cells in two different animals. At the same time, I actually started synthesizing some dyes with my organic chemistry background that were of the same general structure as the procyon dyes. These looked like good candidates because they had a reactive group that could bind to proteins. So in that sense, they looked like they were good candidates. They were used for dyeing fabrics, so they looked like good dyes. Of the 120, we ended up with two or three that looked pretty good, and procyon yellow was one of those. We also started narrowing our search to look for a fluorescent dye. And the reason for that was that we wanted to be able to resolve things that were very small in the nervous system. And if it were a fluorescent dye and scattered light a little bit, we might be able to see even smaller things than without a fluorescent dye. And we could also detect smaller quantities. The person at the dye company assured us that none of the dyes were fluorescent because they didn't want fluorescent dyes for clothing. But when we found protein yellow, we found that it was a fluorescent dye, and they had never seen that because the dye concentration was too high. Any event, we had the dye we wanted, and it looked like it would do everything. So we told everybody and showed everybody, and then started injecting cells. And we injected over 100 cells, had to reconstruct them from scratch because there were no computer, the cells from scratch, because there were no computer reconstruction programs that would identify all the branches of a cell. And we had to do that by serial sectioning ganglia, taking photos of every section, enlarging them on plastic sheets, going to the fluorescence microscope, transferring the fluorescence profiles to the plastic sheets, orienting the plastic sheets with respect to each other, and then making projections in different planes after we did the orienting. So it took us quite a bit of time for doing something that now takes about 10 seconds with the microscopes and programs that are available. Nonetheless, we ended up injecting the cells, convincing ourselves that the neuropil was pretty rigid in terms of the structure, and also began mapping the neuropil, mapping where cells that we identified were projecting processes. And it looked clear that this was the method that was going to allow us to unravel the synaptic connection regions of cells. This 2 years after Bullock and Horridge had published a major text that said that you would never unravel the neuropil because it's too complicated. The lobster had been such a great animal to identify a transmitter compound because of the morphological advantages, really. Limited numbers of cells innervating target tissues, allowing us to find the same cells in different animals and dissect out the same cells. And it had let us do what we thought was a terrific job of identifying a transmitter compound. So then we said, well, why not try to find all the transmitter compounds? Maybe the lobster is going to be great for lots of other transmitter compounds as well. Maybe we can prove that serotonin is a transmitter compound, or prove that something like norepinephrine might be a transmitter compound, prove that glutamate was a transmitter compound. So it really was that it had worked so well in identifying one transmitter, we said, let's try to identify them all and get the evidence that we need. Serotonin was actually first isolated by Maury Rapport in the 1940s, I think. And I knew Maury. He's a very nice gent. He kept talking to me about serotonin. But it really wasn't established that serotonin was a transmitter. People were willing to accept that norepinephrine was a transmitter, but there was still some discussion about serotonin and the roles that it served. It was known to be an important compound, because if you interfered with the metabolism, there were behavioral consequences of doing that, involving sleep, involving learning and memory, involving other important processes that animals went through. But no one had really worked out the circuitry, the system, and what serotonin did in vertebrate systems as well. So we said, well, let's see what the derivatives are of the precursor compounds, tyrosine and tryptophan, in lobsters. And we used a combination of biochemical methods and the hot zap method, and fed radioactive precursors and identified the products that came out. So from tyrosine, we were surprised because while there was dopamine there, and there actually had been some work on dopamine neurons by Ian Cook some years before, revealed by the Falk-Hillarp staining methods that had been developed, there was not a lot of information about how the dopamine was formed, or whether there were other neurons that used dopamine, how the dopamine was used. So dopamine was found, and we found dopamine as well, but to our surprise, there was no norepinephrine. And instead, there was an amine that was structurally related to norepinephrine called octopamine. And octopamine is the phenol analog of norepinephrine. The tyrosine doesn't get a second hydroxyl group put on the ring. Instead, the single hydroxyl group, tyrosine is decarboxylated to tyramine, maintaining the single hydroxyl group. And then the tyramine is metabolized to octopamine exactly in the same way that dopamine would be metabolized to norepinephrine. But there was no norepinephrine. So lobsters had either octopamine or dopamine, but not both, but no norepinephrine. From tryptophan, we found only the one product, and the one product was serotonin. So we started out in earnest to see what we could learn about the roles of these amines in the lobster nervous system. Serotonin had been put on crustacean neuromuscular junctions in the late 1950s, starting then. Grunfest had a series of papers on that, in which he had some very interesting results. Synaptic responses got big, and muscles contracted, and it looked like it was doing important stuff. Nerve axons would fire. Kuffler and Doodle were actually using serotonin to make synaptic responses bigger. But it was more a pharmacological oddity. Here's a chemical that we can put on the synapse, and it makes things look bigger. On the nerve terminal, there was not only a single site of action to serotonin, but there were two sites of action. And they differed in the time course of the response. In both cases, you increase the amount of transmitter, both responses. One of the responses decayed away very quickly, and the second response decayed away only very slowly. And we did a little pharmacology, and then Harold Atwood in Canada did some more pharmacology on that, and found that one of the responses was a cyclic nucleotide response, and one was a phosphatidyl inositol response. So two distinct sites of action, probably two distinct receptors presynaptically on the excitatory nerve terminal for serotonin. On the inhibitory nerve terminal, there also was a response to serotonin. And surprisingly, it also increased transmitter release at the inhibitory terminal. And it acted directly on the muscle to enhance the contractions in the muscle. So serotonin was working on all of the nervous parts of this one preparation to make the whole preparation work better. And it was a finite time course that all these actions took place in. And within 30 minutes or so, the responses all decayed away. But for 30 minutes, things behaved differently. We looked at the effects of octopamine as well. And although we didn't see an effect of octopamine on the excitatory response, Atwood picked up on that, and he found if he stimulated the excitatory nerve in advance, then he could see a response of octopamine, a facilitating response. And we also saw responses of octopamine directly on the muscle and didn't see anything on the inhibitory nerve terminal. So receptors were distributed on both kinds of nerve terminals and both kinds of muscle, and the muscle itself, in such a way to modify the way the muscles function for a finite and rather extended period of time. We were seeing all these responses of these chemicals, but we also knew that none of the chemicals were either in the muscle or in the nerves innervating the muscle. So we knew that those chemicals had to be reaching the muscles by some other source. So we had a puzzle. I mean, we had a muscle that responded to amines, and there were no amines there, had to be reached via the hemolymph, the blood of the animal. And we knew a likely place where the material could be released in the hemolymph. And we knew that the cells that contained these substances must be somehow in the central nervous system where they might be doing other things. So the question was, how did this all work? How could you piece it all together? And we were focusing on the hormonal role, the mechanism of action of the hormonal role. And Marge Livingston was my graduate student at the time. And Marge said, well, you guys are suggesting that this stuff is a hormone. And if it's a hormone, then I'm going to inject it into lobsters and see what it does. And we said, no, Marge, that's not the way it works. I mean, this is not like, you know, insulin or something like that. This is something that's in the nervous system. It's very highly integrated. And nonetheless, Marge disappeared. We were down at the Marine Biological Lab in the summer, and Marge came into the lab, grabbed me by the hand, and said, I have something I want to show you. So we went downstairs, and I looked in the tank, and there were two lobsters there. And one of them was standing with its claws up in the air like that, as tall as can be on its walking legs, with its abdomen, its tail tucked underneath. And the other one was lying close to the ground with its claws pointed straight in front of it, and sort of groveling on the ground. And I said, well, you know, I mean, what'd you bring me down there? I mean, that's a winner and that's a loser of a fight. And she said, wrong. She said, that one has been injected with serotonin, pointing to the one looking like this, and that one's been injected with octopamine, pointing to the one that with the claws straight in front and very, very low to the substrate. And that experiment and that moment is what started us on the idea that maybe when animals become dominant, serotonin neuron function becomes more important, and when animals become subordinate, octopamine neuron function becomes more important. And that took us through the next 15 or 20 years of our scientific lives. So here's one of these serotonin cells that has its cell body in the central nervous system, and there's a set of endings in the central nervous system as well. And then those cells send an axon forward, and in every anterior ganglion, all the way up the nerve cord that's cut off here, they have one set of endings in the CNS, like this one, and another set of endings out in the periphery here. So this is one of the points where serotonin is released, and the far end of that nerve, which is cut off here, is another point where serotonin is released. This is how a single cell can influence things within the central nervous system and also in the peripheral muscles by the release at two different points. So a single cell is doing both of these jobs. So this is a schematic that shows how a serotonin cell works and influences all parts of the system, influences the muscles in the periphery, and influences the central circuitry at the same time. So in response to environmental cues, the serotonin cells themselves are activated, but also these neurons called command neurons are activated, and the central command circuitries will read out from the central nervous system via circuitry and motor neurons a pattern that excites the flexor muscles and inhibits the extensor muscles. And via that kind of command neuron, that's how animals stand up tall and put their claws up in the air, looking like a dominant animal. At the same time, the command neurons activate the serotonin cells, and the serotonin cells, remember, had two sets of endings, central endings and endings in the neurosecretory regions that release into the hemolymph. So from a cell that has these two sets of endings, you can have actions on the central nervous system to amplify the output of this circuitry, and actions on the muscles to make the muscles work better. So a single cell, through two different sets of endings, influences all of the circuitry that's involved in the postural regulation. In the vertebrate literature, if you looked at the generalizations that had been made about the role of serotonin, it was that lowered levels of serotonin were important in aggression, and elevated levels were good for good social behavior and everything. So there was something exactly opposite in what we were seeing in the lobsters and what other people had reported before in the vertebrate systems. We found that interesting and challenging as well. It didn't particularly bother us, because the development of the nervous system is different in lobsters and in vertebrates. But we had to recognize that you couldn't make the generalization that elevated levels of serotonin are good for social skills And lowered levels are good for increased levels of aggression. That generalization didn't translate from vertebrate systems to the crustacean systems we were working with. There are about 14 different kinds of subtypes of serotonin receptors. And there are pretty good pharmacological reagents that can distinguish between the subtypes of receptors. When we started working with the serotonin effects in the lobsters, we screened a lot of the drugs that we knew would block different categories of receptors in the vertebrate system. Unfortunately, what we found was that most of those drugs did not block the effects of serotonin or did not amplify the effects of serotonin in the same way that they did in the vertebrate system. We started doing the quantitative analysis of behavior in the 1980s. This was very much influenced by my colleague, Robert Huber, who I worked with. And Robert was Conrad Lorenz's last student, so he was a traditionally trained behaviorist. And he introduced me to the concept that you have to study behavior before you can carry out, before you can start looking at the nervous system and understand what's happening in the nervous system. I had come from a different background. I came from a physiological, biochemical background, and I was taking the traditional approach that led to the behavior by the wonderful discovery by Marge Livingston that she injected serotonin and octopamine and got these two opposing postures. That's what led us to the behavior. I didn't start from the perspective of a behaviorist. So we were taking the traditional biochemical, molecular, cellular approach to the problem. So, and we were pursuing it. We were moving in the direction of focusing on serotonin, because lots of folks had found that serotonin was important in aggression in mammalian species. Any manipulation you made, where you change the level of serotonin, you change the amount of aggression in animals. So serotonin was a logical place to focus, and we said, well, we'll just study the serotonin system to death. We'll learn everything we can about it, and somehow we're going to learn something about at least the role of serotonin in aggression. That's why we were into the details of mapping the serotonin system, learning how serotonin neurons work, and studying the molecular biology. We probably should have done the behavior first, but we basically were doing them at the same time. So the fighting behavior involves things that you can look at and you can recognize. And it involves low-intensity stuff like displaying the claws, where animals stand up really tall, something we called Merrill spread. It involves limited aggression, where animals push and shove. And it involves high-level aggression, where animals use their claws and try to tear the other animal to bits. That description, the word description of all the things that an animal does, is called an ethogram. And it's something that behaviorists have been doing for years. But you can make it even more quantitative by scoring how much of the time an animal spends doing a particular pattern and how often that pattern transitions to another pattern. You can do a statistical analysis of the behavior. It leads to something called the Markov first order chain. And the Markov first order chain is a pictorial representation of a quantitative analysis of behavior, which we did first with the lobsters, all inspired by Robert Huber being in the lab. And he did all the initial analysis of that. That's exactly the same kind of approach we took later in our work with the fruit flies, and that's exactly the same kind of approach that people who are interested in behavior should be taking, we believe, in any experiments that they're going to do, any genetic experiments that they're going to do, trying to influence behavior later. Lobsters are great animals for the study of aggression, but there were limits on the questions that you could ask with the lobsters. And there were two things that I was really very interested in starting from the work with the lobsters, but certainly continuing into the future. One of those things was, how does behavior get into the nervous system? How do these kind of complicated patterns, these rituals that we and every other species on Earth go through all day long, how does that get put into the nervous system? How much of a role do genes play in that? How much of a role does experience play in that? How much of a role do hormones play in that? But the lobster, I saw no way of getting at that question, because you need an animal where you can manipulate the genome to see and explore the role of genes. And that, at the time and for the immediate future, even now, you can't do with lobsters. So lobsters were the wrong animals for asking that question. But it's a fundamental question in behavior. It's one that I wanted to get at. Second question was, although we had been working on the role of serotonin in aggression, we and many other people, no one can tell you in any species of animals what a serotonin neuron actually does while an animal's fighting. Does the neuron fire before the fight to prime the animal? Does it fire during the fight? Does it fire after the fight? And the reasons that no one can tell you that is there are relatively few serotonergic neurons in any nervous system. They're usually deep in the brain in vertebrates and similarly distributed in the invertebrates. And if you try to put a microelectrode in a cell like that, first of all, they're hard to find. And if you are lucky enough to find them, once the animals start fighting, the electrode's going to be gone, because fights are violent social interactions between two animals, and you wouldn't be able to record from that cell. In flies, there are genetic methods that we knew could be used to let us manipulate the serotonin nerve cells while the flies are fighting and ask the question of what does a serotonin neuron do while an animal is fighting. So those two questions were fundamental, and they were the main part of why we switched. Now, there was another part. When I found that there was no unique contribution that I could make, I mean, we would keep making contributions, but there was nothing, I didn't see us busting away and opening new territory. And I started feeling crowded and feeling that I was kind of losing my creativity in this project, or my potential to be creative, which is another reason that we felt that the move to the fruit flies, with the challenges that that offered, would be moving in a new direction. And I felt that that was an important reason why we made the switch as well. I found out that fruit flies fight about 15 years ago, after a seminar that I gave in the University of Connecticut Medical Center, and a gentleman came down from the audience, and he said to me, do you know that fruit flies fight? And I said, he said, well, I'll send you some reprints about this. And so he sent me the reprints, and there were only a few papers that showed that fruit flies fight, dating back to 1915 when Sturtevant did his work, some papers in the 1960s, some papers in the 1980s, including some beautiful papers by Ari Hoffman on the aggression. All of these had been done in a complex social situation, but they demonstrated that flies fight. So over the next several years, whenever I would give a talk and visit friends who worked with fruit flies, I'd say, well, do you know that fruit flies fight? And their general response was, so what I said is, why don't you work on the fighting behavior and we'll work together on this? And they would all say, no, you do it. So finally, about the turn of the century, about 2000, I said, okay, we'll do it. I mean, it's time for us to learn how to do the fruit fly fights, and to see whether, because the genome was available, because powerful methods were available, we could adapt the knowledge of the genome and the powerful methods to the study of this complex behavior. The first challenge was to figure out how to get just two flies to fight, because all the earlier work had been done with populations of flies. And we felt if we were ever going to manipulate genes, which is the direction we knew we ultimately would go, that we had to have just two flies fighting, possibly two mutants, or possibly a normal against a mutant, to see what was abnormal in the behavior when we started manipulating genes. And we were using three things then to attract the flies to a place where they would want to find resources that they would want to compete over. We used light. Flies like to be in the light. We used food. The whole surface was food. And we used a potential mate. And in that way, the two males would soon get on the surface and soon start competing for the resources that were there. So then we did the analysis of the fly fighting behavior exactly the same way we did the analysis of the lobster behavior. We scored, we wrote down what flies do in fights, and we constructed our ethogram, and we constructed the Markov chains from that that described all of the components wherein that took place in the fly fights. And there were very interesting things going on in those fights, involving a whole lot of different behavioral patterns. So now I'll show you some of the behavioral patterns that you see. And at low intensity, there's something called fencing behavior. And here's the low intensity fence. And this will clear in just a second, and you'll see them pushing each other. All right? And they do it with their forelegs and their other legs, and they're just pushing against each other, trying to push the other guy off the surface. That's low intensity. And at the mid intensity, there's some chasing behavior, where one goes chasing after the other. Clearly, this is a winner in this fight. And then here's some, my favorite, boxing, where they actually get up on their hind legs and they duke it out. And this is a rare pattern of behavior, but you can see it here, and we do see it in many of the fights that we carry out. Then something even rarer is tussling, which is often followed by one of the flies throwing the other completely off the surface of the food. Question was, do the females fight the same way that males fight?
This is a female fight. Starts out with fencing and a couple of quick wing flicks, and then one fly gives a number of headbutts and will completely drive the other female off the surface. Much less intense than the male fights.
And so we started watching and scoring female fights and did the Markov chain analysis of the female fights. And we found that while some of the patterns were the same, some were uniquely female. And in particular, the females didn't do this lunging behavior. They didn't do a lot of the high intensity stuff. They didn't do this lunging behavior. They didn't do the boxing behavior they didn't do the tussling that the male flies show. But instead, they did have mid-intensity components of behavior where they would make contact with each other. These were called shove and headbutt. So one fundamental question that we were interested in was, how do the male patterns of fighting behavior get into the male brains and the female patterns of fighting behavior get into the female brains? Lunging is seen only in males. So I'm going to show it to you in real time first, and you're going to be very unimpressed with what you see. So there's the lunge, and that was it. And did you catch that? Okay. So now I want to show you that something that looks very trivial, when you single frame through it at 500 frames a second, is very complex behavior. And remember that the behavior you're going to look at is all specified by genes. So here is one male approaching the other, and it starts to stand up, and it puts its wings up in the air for balance. That's the forelegs up in the air. And then puts the wings down again for balance, making a tripod there. Stands up straighter and straighter till it's at about 90 degrees, and then snaps down on the opponent so fast that even at 500 frames a second, it's still a blur. You can't see what's happening. Then it strikes the opponent, and you can see the opponent go down. Sometimes it flattens the opponent, and it grabs onto the other fly. And you can see her holding the body there, him holding the body there, and then holding the wings as the other one struggles to escape. And the other one rises in the air. You'll see the wings buckle as it's trying to escape from the other fly and finally pulls free of the other fly. So something that looked very trivial when you saw it in real time, when you see it in slow motion, there's a wealth of detail there. And the important thing to remember is all of that is specified by genes. What you'll see is the female doesn't rise in the air like the male does in the lunge behavior, but instead charges at the opponent and hits the opponent with a head. And there's one headbutt, there's a second headbutt. And we can look at it a little bit more slowly here, and you'll see that one is approaching the other and charges the other one, hits the other one with the head, and then hits the other one with the head again. So that's one of the two patterns shown by females. This is the other pattern, which is the shoving behavior, where they're actually just pushing the other female out of the way. And here you'll see a whole series of seven of them in a row, where they're just trying to push the female off the surface away from the food. So there are two directions that the work moved from that point. One was continuing the analysis of the behavior and examining the consequences of winning and losing fights. And the second generation, the second direction, was to start manipulating genes and ask for the consequences of that. Now, there's a very powerful method that became available only in 1994. In fact, had we it's called the Galfour method, and that method was developed by scientists at Harvard Medical School. The consequence of using this system is that we can manipulate any gene that we want, any place that we want in the fly nervous system, any time that we want in development. So we can take serotonin neurons that are functioning normally by making the appropriate mutants using this Galfour system. We can take serotonin neurons that are functioning normally, say at one temperature, and change the temperature, having put a temperature-sensitive mutation in serotonin neurons, change the temperature in such a way that those nerve cells stop functioning within a minute. So while the animals are behaving, we can change the temperature, and the temperature-sensitive mutation will kick in and change the way those neurons are functioning. So we can turn those neurons on and off while animals are behaving. And we can do that before the animals are fighting, during the time when the animals are fighting, or after the time that the animals are fighting. This is an incredibly powerful method. It's been a dream of people who are interested in behavior to have animals behaving and then say, here's a piece of the circuit I'm very interested in, the hormonal part of the circuit, and say, okay, I want to pluck it out for a while and see what happens. And I want to put it back in for a while and see what happens. And that's what you can do using the genetic methods that are available in flies. And that's what we never would have been able to do had we continued with the lobsters. Had we started work with the flies earlier, we wouldn't have had that method available. We would have had to use traditional genetic methods. So in a way, our starting this work in, as late as 2000, we were only 5 years into the very powerful, extensive use of this very powerful method. In flies, we know that this single gene, fruitless, is important. There's going to be other genes involved as well, obviously, but this single gene, fruitless, is involved with both courtship and aggression. If you put the male forms of fruitless in females, you get females courting females as if they're males. If you put the male forms of fruitless into females, females box, they show the male patterns of fighting behavior. And we figured the easiest way to do that is to have a fly with a masculinized brain, a female fly with a masculinized brain, fighting against a male fly with a feminized brain. So here you can see the female. She's bigger than the male. And I'll do this in single frame so you can sort of see what's happening. So the female turns around to approach the male, and then she stands up to box. And here, boxing is something that females never do unless we make this genetic manipulation. So the female is standing up ready to box. And in male fights, when one male stands up to box, then the other male will stand up to box as well. But here, the male fly sees the female up there, and she's waving her legs around, waiting for the male to come up and box, and he doesn't recognize the signal to stand up and box. So when you've changed the brain, you've not only changed the pattern of behavior that the fly can do, you've also changed the recognition of the pattern. And that's a subtle difference. So the female's up there, and she finally gives up and says, well, this is not someone worth fighting with, so I'm just going to go back and eat. So the manipulation of this single gene makes females both court-like males and fight-like males. Is that notion something that can be extrapolated to higher forms? Does it lead to, I mean, these things are closely related in all species. One of the worst forms of human aggression directed by males towards females is in rape, is using things that are sexual in a highly aggressive way. How does that linkage happen in higher forms? How does it happen in primates? How does it happen in humans? How far can we push the work with flies to any understanding of what's happening in higher forms, and in particular in humans, in stories like violence and aggression? There is no homologue of the fruitless gene in humans, so we're not going to be able to make a direct extrapolation of the type that's been made in developmental biology. The first genes that were developed, that were identified, that were important in developmental biology were done in fruit flies. These were the homeobox genes, a wonderful work of Ed Lewis at California Institute of Technology. And that, there were direct homologs of those genes found all the way up into human beings. So that led to the a very powerful direct translation from work that was done in fruit flies to work that was done in human beings. We're not going to see that with aggression in the flies, or with courtship behavior in the flies, because there is no homologue of fruitless, and there's nothing that works like fruitless that we know about. But there will be a role of genes in this. And our feeling is, if we can understand how genes put these very complicated patterns of behavior, like the lunging behavior that you saw this movie of, how genes put patterns of behavior like that in the nervous system, it will give us some insight into the things that genes can do to influence behavior. In moving into the fruit flies, I have the feeling we're moving in completely new directions. We're moving in new territory. We have a toolbox of wonderful methods that are available. And the challenge for us is, what's the method that's going to let us now go beyond where other people have been before? What's the method that's going to allow us to gain insight into this amazing thing, complex social behavior, and move it in directions that no one's been able to move it before? So the excitement is high, excitement level is high, the challenge is great, and we feel that we're right there, poised to take the next steps in this direction. I can tell you, it's enormously exciting to be at this particular juncture. I can also tell you it's great fun, because it's fun to watch the flies doing all these things. The movies are wonderful. They're funny. But the having the ability to manipulate the behavior by manipulating genes now, and understanding, because we understand the behavior, understanding the consequences of the genetic manipulations that we've been making in this, is just incredibly exciting. I can't imagine anything more exciting than that.